NASA's reporting before the break on the president's seemingly reborn birther views dovetails with reporting from the New York Times' Maggie Haberman and Jonathan Martin on that and the Access Hollywood tape. They suggest that he is, to put it bluntly, losing his grip in some way or abandoning his grip on facts that he himself once acknowledged. Citing advisors, Maggie and Jonathan write, quote, "In recent months, they say Mr. Trump has used closed-door conversations to question the authenticity of President Barack Obama's birth certificate." Now, just to remind you, whether or not he now regrets doing it, he gave up on this bogus conspiracy theory, as Jim Acosta was just talking about, more than a year ago.
Hillary Clinton and her campaign of 2008 started the birther controversy. I finished it. I finished it. You know what I mean. President Barack Obama was born in the United States, period.
So he disavowed his birther talk, but now he's reportedly back at it. And as Maggie Haberman first reported on Monday, he's continued to cast doubt on whether it's his voice on the Access Hollywood tape, the very tape that he already apologized for. Quoting again from Maggie and Jonathan Martin's latest story on this, quote, "In recent days, he has continued to seed doubt about his appearance on the Access Hollywood tape, stunning his advisors. And here's what he said about it the day it came out.
I've never said I'm a perfect person, nor pretended to be someone that I'm not. I've said and done things I regret, and the words released today on this more than a decade-old video are one of them. Anyone who knows me knows these words don't reflect who I am. I said it, I was wrong, and I apologize."
I said it. So what he acknowledged and apologized for, he's now not sure is even his voice, and his advisors, according to the Times reporting, are stunned. Joining us now is CNN political analyst and New York Times White House correspondent Maggie Haberman. There's a lot to get to, but just this is the thing that's just hard to wrap my mind around. I mean, I co-moderated the second debate where we questioned him about it. He acknowledged what he said. He said it was, you know, locker room talk, whatever. He, right in that video, he acknowledged it. How is it possible that he's now saying to other people, three people, according to your sources, it may not have been him?
I think that you have to think with this presidency that we keep looking for a bottom where there's just the limit that he's not going to go any further in terms of either his conduct or reinventing history or something. And there is no bottom. He will just keep doing this. So I think if you look at it in that context, it's not surprising. It is, however, very hard to wrap your mind around because, to your point, this is one of the few times that we have ever heard him.
He apologized.
He apologized and he acknowledged it was him. And there is no kernel of truth that he can point to, which is often what he does. But what he has been doing his entire career, and you know this very well, is sort of trying to will certain facts as he wants them to be into existence. The other thing he said to you in that debate was that it was very embarrassing, and it was a very striking moment because he almost never says something like that. This was one of the rare times that you can think of him experiencing public humiliation. He did not consider his divorces to be humiliation. A New York Post front page headline about his sex life with Marla Maples, he was proud of. He loved that story. His bankruptcies did not really consider to be a personal loss. This was very, very embarrassing to him, and I think that he has tried, by virtue of the fact that he won, to essentially recast reality. But for other people who are not in that unreality bubble, it's very distorting.
I mean, he hasn't said this publicly in a speech,
which
would be a whole other level.
Correct.
But the fact that he has said this to other people, you know, he's president of the United States, things are going to get out.
Right.
It's just sort of stunning.
Well, also, I mean, the thing that we know about Donald Trump is he never says something to just one person. Mm. I mean, these conversations that he has are always with multiple
it's
people.
It's like he's trying it out almost.
Correct. He tests things. He sees how people react. He says it sometimes to make himself feel better. What we don't know, and we are not qualified to analyze because that would require a psychiatric degree and actually somebody treating him, we don't know whether this is, you know, he's lost his grip on reality or he is just trying to sell people on a version of reality and that he knows very well what happened. The fact that he has not said it publicly suggests to me that he knows pretty well that that is his voice on that tape.
I mean, again, I can't believe we're going back to the Obama birth certificate story.
Right.
Is it, you know, what Jim Acosta was saying is that he had, according to a source, he had, the president had suggested that, you know, it was maybe a mistake for him to acknowledge the birth certificate, that the president was actually born in the United States. Do we know if he actually does believe the president was born in the United States, or if it was just he feels regret that he politically that it was not a smart move to
do. I don't think it's an or. I think he has said different things to different people on this topic. And, you know, I spoke to one White House advisor who was adamant with me that they, you know, they had never heard him do this. And that's very possible. But, you know, that doesn't mean that other people have not heard him do this. As you said, he tries things out. I think he is trying these things out. I do think he thinks that apologizing was a mistake, but I also think that he, because he can never admit that he's wrong, even in that apology, whatever it was, quote unquote, about the birth certificate, wasn't really an apology. Right. He said, Hillary Clinton did this and I finished it. It's very hard for him to say that he just got it wrong, and so he tries to sort of reverse engineer this stuff so that actually he was right in the first place. And he tries to convince other people of it.
I want to point out that the White House has pushed back on some of your reporting, saying on the New York Times story, there are a number of inaccuracies in that report. Each of the issues they raised up, the president for quite some time now has addressed. Nothing has changed on his views. When pressed for what the inaccuracies were, they wouldn't elaborate.
Right, that's not an answer. Right. And so I don't know what they're pushing back on other than literally going their hands like this. it reminds me a little bit of when Sean Spicer was, and really he was tasked with an unenviable job there, but Sean Spicer was widely condemning the report by Glenn Thrush and me that the president had been wearing a bathrobe in the residence, which the president, for whatever reason, took great exception to. And Sean kept saying he doesn't even own a bathrobe. And there was everything is wrong in that story. And that was not true. I think I think White House advisors who have to address this, if you will look at their language, it's pretty careful. And they're not saying exactly what they're referring to. They just keep saying his statement from last year stands.
The three videos that he tweeted out from this far-right British group, I mean, I guess it shouldn't surprise anybody, but based on comments he's made just in the past year, but do you know the process by which this stuff even gets in front of him? I mean, is it, I don't know, I think I read Ann Coulter had tweeted one of the videos. It maybe he saw it there and then looked at the deputy leaders, because he was retweeting not Ann Coulter, right, but the deputy leader.
Yeah, I mean, he has, it's funny, his Twitter habits have actually evolved over time, and he used to be essentially, especially during the campaign, it was just output, and now, as one White House advisor put it to me, it's both input and output, and so there is a lot of scrolling through his feed, and he will also look at what people have liked or retweeted of his own or tweeted at him. So there is a lot more commentary that he's pulling himself. In the old days, it was various member in the old days of this year, but in the old days, some members of the White House team would put suggested tweets in front of him. Often Dan Scavino, the social media director, would be responsible for those kinds of things. But my understanding from two advisors in the West Wing is that this was not a Dan Scavino move.
Maggie Haberman, appreciate it as always. Thank you very much.